You're going to hear a great speaker today. When I was in Congress as a freshman in 1979, there was a young man on the staff, and you knew that Ray Mabus was going places. And he got things done. He's a graduate of Ole Miss, has a master's at Johns Hopkins, and his law degree from Harvard. He served in the Navy as a surface warfare officer aboard the USS Little Rock. And then he worked as a law clerk for the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals in New Orleans. After his years in the Navy, that's when we crossed paths. He started working for the Ag Committee, as legal clerk for the Ag Committee. In 1987, he was elected governor of Mississippi. He served as governor of Mississippi and did a lot of improvement in education. Then President Clinton appointed him ambassador to Saudi Arabia. Then President Obama appointed him as Secretary of the Navy. As Secretary of the Navy, he has a budget of over $150 billion and over 900,000 people report to him. He is pro-military, he's pro-American, he's a great American, a true patriot, and we are fortunate to have Secretary of Navy Ray Mabus as our commencement speaker today. Ray Mabus.
Chancellor Kent Hance, thank you so much for that. The amazing thing, when I was a brand new staff member and he was a brand new member of Congress, was that Kent Hance took time out to know who the staff was. And I think that speaks to his character and to the type of people who are at Texas Tech. Now, as he said, I'm an Ole Miss graduate. And I have really appreciated the hospitality here. And I would never think of mentioning that the last time I was with a big group of Texas Tech people was at the 2009 Cotton Bowl. I wouldn't think of mentioning that Texas Tech was 11-1 and Ole Miss was 8-4. Wouldn't think of even going near the fact that Texas Tech was favored by 10 points, that y'all were ranked number 7 and we were ranked number 20. And of course, it's just an afterthought that we won 47-24. I'm glad to be back here. So to the faculty, the students, the family, the friends, most of all to the class of 2012, watch very carefully because you won't see this Ole Miss graduate do this that often. This university, as it has been since the very first students arrived here, all 914 of them in 1925, one of the finest schools in the United States. As Chancellor Hance said, your graduates are leaders in every field. And that's a testament not only to the skill and the talent of the faculty and the staff, but everybody sitting in front of me today. The victory bells ring for you from your first days as freshmen, finding your way around campus and getting kicked off the double T bench to today. You've done the work, you've put in the time, you've made the effort. Today's yours. But in a very real sense, today belongs to a lot of other people too, because you wouldn't be here without them. Find every one of you are the mothers and fathers, the grandmothers, the grandfathers, the brothers, the sisters, the friends, the coaches, the teachers, hundreds and hundreds of other people. A lot of them you probably don't even know. who made today possible. Now, after the ceremony, and I know you're going to do this anyway, but give those who have supported you every step of the way an extra hug. Thank them one more time for what they've done, for the sacrifices that they've made, because today is their day just as much as it is yours. And parents, sitting here today, I know exactly how you feel, because in May I sat and watched my oldest daughter graduate, and I felt that mixture of pride and sadness. And the only thing that confused me was, in my mind's eye, Elizabeth Mabus was still 3 years old, asking for one more ride on my shoulders. And I could not understand why a university would be granting a three-year-old a degree. It is also important to remember those who, in a larger sense, are to be thanked for a day like today. Those who have worn or are currently wearing the uniform of our country. Those who stand the watch every day to keep us safe. Most of you who are graduating today were in middle school or younger when 9/11 happened. That's the world you've grown up in. Earlier this year, we marked the one-year anniversary of the joint operation led by Navy SEALs, which brought the world's most notorious terrorist to justice, finally. And while those actions by the team that conducted the bin Laden raid were truly extraordinary, equally extraordinary actions happen every day by those who serve and those who wear the cloth of this nation. Every sailor, every Marine, every soldier, every Coast Guardsman, every airman is just as professional, just as dedicated, and just as skilled as those who carried out that mission, and we ought to be just as proud of every single one of them. Your name is Texas Tech, and so you're comfortable in dealing with numbers and statistics. And here's one, and it's a statistic that ought to scare you. Fewer than 25% of people 17 to 24 years old in America qualify to serve in our military. One in four. That's because they don't have the education, because they don't have the health, or it's because they've got a criminal record. Now, in our military, in our society, and in our economy, there are no jobs, there are no room for strong backs and weak minds anymore. And there's one more number to keep in mind. Fewer than 1% of America today serves in the armed forces of America. 1% keeps the other 99% safe. 1% has volunteered, given freely of themselves for year after year after year, have sacrificed day after day, enduring hardships, family separations, incredibly high operational tempo. We have been at war for more than a decade, and thousands have paid the ultimate price. Tens of thousands more have come home with scars, both visible and invisible, that they will carry with them until their final day. We are able to do what we do because of what they have done and are doing. We are able to pursue our lives because they have been willing to risk and sometimes lose theirs. As was said so eloquently in World War II, they give their today for our tomorrow. I'm incredibly fortunate to lead the Navy and Marine Corps and to get to meet so many sailors and Marines around the world doing amazing work on behalf of us all. And I want to tell you about one day in the Navy and Marine Corps and what it does for this country. Picked one day, March 19th of last year. On that day, ships and submarines of the Navy launched cruise missiles over Libya to establish a no-fly zone, and a big deck amphibious ship provided air support and rescued an Air Force pilot that had gone down. On that same day, we had 20,000 Marines in combat in Afghanistan. On that same day, 20,000 sailors were at sea and on the ground supporting that fight in Afghanistan. On that same day, we had ships fighting pirates off the Horn of Africa. On that same day, we had ships in the Caribbean interdicting drugs. On that same day, we had ships going around Africa and around South America and through the South Pacific, giving humanitarian assistance and disaster relief. On that same day, we had a carrier strike group giving aid to the Japanese after the terrible tsunami. On that same day, we had an amphibious ready group from Okinawa in Japan with the Marines and sailors also giving aid. On that same day, we had sailors and Marines in countless countries doing countless things, but all with the same purpose, protecting us. That's one day. One day of what our Navy and Marine Corps do. That's one day that represents the skill, the talent, the devotion, the patriotism that we have in the Navy and the Marine Corps and all across our military. And graduates of this great university have served with distinction in every branch of our service. Some sitting here today have already been part of that proud heritage, and some are about to join. Five members of this class are being commissioned this weekend from ROTC into the Army and the Air Force. And there are 1,100 veterans, military service members, active duty enrolled here. 400 faculty members and staff have military backgrounds, and over 1,000 military dependents call Texas Tech home. This has been the way at Texas Tech for a long time. After World War II, you got more than your fair share of returning veterans. Some of the 16 million people who served during that war came back, went to school on the GI Bill, expanded their horizons, and expanded their lives. A lot of your parents and your grandparents, great-grandparents, were part of that generation. The so-called greatest generation literally saved our country. They grew up during the Depression, won World War II, were tested in places like Iwo Jima and Anzio, Casablanca and Guadalcanal, Normandy and Midway. And during their early lives, when they were no older than you, they saw more and experienced more than most of us can even imagine, and then they came back and changed America. I want to tell you a quick story about one of them, a fellow Mississippian of mine, Jack Lucas from Hattiesburg. He lied about his age, joined the Marines at 14, made his way all the way through boot camp, and got to Hawaii with his unit when they found out how old he was. They separated him from his unit and told him they were going to send him home. Jack Lucas decided to stow away on a ship to keep from being sent home, so he got on the first ship that was leaving, didn't know where it was going. By the time they found him, it was too late to send him back, and that ship was going to Iwo Jima. He went ashore in one of the first waves. He and his unit were in a foxhole when two grenades came in. Jack Lucas grabbed them both and fell on them. Now the sand at Iwo Jima is black volcanic sand. It's very soft, very fine. He shoved the grenades as far down into that sand as he could. Both those grenades went off, and he was hurt pretty badly. His unit thought he was dead. But a corpsman came by and found out that he was still alive and patched him up and got him back onto one of those ships and sent him home. He went to the White House where he was awarded the Medal of Honor. Then he went back home and started the ninth grade. There are literally thousands of stories of heroism like Jack Lucas, and you here today carry that legacy. You're the descendants of that greatest generation. You have exactly the same potential to change America, to make America better, and to change the world that that generation had. But whether what you have done and whether you will be held up 40, 50, 60, 70 years from now to graduates sitting where you are is up to you and up to what you do over the next few decades. Because one thing is very certain as you go into an uncertain world, there is no end to things that need doing. You sure don't have to join the military to serve, although we do need skilled, talented, dedicated people. There are so many ways to make things better. There are acts of quiet heroism that go on every day. It's the teacher staying after school to help a struggling student. It's the nurse staying after the shift is ended with a patient. It's the neighbor mows the yard of the elderly neighbor. It's the farmer who puts people through college anonymously, not telling anyone, even his own family. It's the saddle tramps and other organizations working on this campus for a better Texas Tech during the precious little spare time that you have. So do you graduates. Do something bigger than yourself. Do something outside yourselves. Do something to give back to this unique country of ours. Do something to help people that you will probably never know, and they won't know that you did it. Do something that's not just about you or your personal advancement. Now there's nothing wrong with making money, and there's nothing wrong with being a success in your chosen profession, and there's nothing wrong and a whole lot right with taking care of yourself and your family. But at the end of your life, most important things are not going to be the money or the stuff that you've accumulated. I, for one, have never seen a hearse with a U-Haul attached. The important things are going to be the people you've loved, the lives you've improved, the futures you've made brighter. You don't have to be in the Marine Corps, but maybe the Peace Corps. You don't have to run for office, but vote. And don't let the issues of your day pass you by. Get involved. Get involved in your community, your church, your school. Get involved in your state, your country, the world, and be passionate about it. We need your heads. We need your hands. We need your hearts. Do something that will last. Do something that you won't see the results of the next day or the next year or maybe ever. Wordsworth wrote that the best portion of a good man's life is little, nameless, unremembered acts of kindness and love. My father was an older member of that greatest generation. He died in 1986 when he was 85 years old. He owned the hardware store in Ackerman, Mississippi, and he grew trees for a living. The last year of his life, did not cut a single tree, but he planted thousands. Now, he knew for an absolute fact that he would never, ever get any benefit from those trees. He knew for an absolute fact that he would never see them grow and mature. He knew for an absolute fact that none of what he was doing would he ever see come to fruition. But he did it. He did it as an act of hope. He did it as an act of faith. He did it for me. He did it for his granddaughters that he never met. He did it for their children and their children, who I will never meet. He did it out of hope. He did it out of faith. So I want you to cherish this day, this graduation. And when it's over, when you've turned in your caps and gowns, go out and do something that will be cherished while you're here and when you're gone. Commit an act of faith. Commit an act of hope. Decide what trees you're going to plant. Congratulations.
Ray, thank you very much. He flew from Washington to here to speak and will be going right back. And to have someone of his caliber to speak at your class is quite an event. We're very proud that he would do this.